I can't push the button because my nails are too flipping long. It's right.
Oh, me too.
it's right up here. Okay. There it is. Thank you.
Don't they look beautiful? She's so pretty.
I love you.
They match my pants. Almost afraid I wasn't going to be able to hold the drumsticks. They're completely impractical.
Good morning, Christ the Cornerstone.
Good morning.
I'm getting the obnoxious signal from the back. Thank you, Pastor Tosh, for getting us hooked up. Thank you very much. We're so glad. Welcome to everyone who's here this morning. We're glad that you decided to join us, whether you're here or you're watching on Facebook. Hello there. We are so glad that you've decided to take a moment out of your week, your weekend, your long weekend, right? And just rest and be here with us. We really have no announcements. It's my kind of Sunday morning, so we're just going to pray and get right into the service. Dear God, we thank you so much for this church. We thank you so much for this time and this moment that we can take a break from our life and come into your presence, God. I just ask that you be with everything that happens this morning, God. The music, the broadcast, the sermon, God, the prayers that we lift up to you, God. May it all be done for your glory and that you be at the center of all of it. We're thankful for this time that we can come, just sit in your presence, God. Just be with us, fill us with the Holy Spirit. Let our hearts be moved to grow closer and closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Good morning. All right, if you would stand with us, if you're willing and able, we're going to start with Shout to the Lord, so I've got to be able to hear you, okay? One, two, ready. Go.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge.
So much for your love for us, for your faithfulness to us, Lord God. Father, we ask that you would just be with us, help us to rid ourselves of ourselves, empty us of our selfish attitudes, our moodiness, whatever it is, Lord, that might be hiding our light under the bushel, Lord God. Father, I pray that you would let that light shine through in our lives and forgive us for the times when we don't allow you to shine through our lives. We just thank you, Lord God, that the battle is yours. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay.
All I see is the battle. You see my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain moved. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night, oh God. The battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me?
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you.
Praise you, Jesus.
When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. Thank you, God. When all I see is a cross, God, you see the empty tomb. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees. Jesus, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through.
Praise the Lord. You may be seated if you like. This is our time of offering. So we just want to come before the Lord and honor Him, not only with our monetary means, but also just with everything. For me, this week, my offering, my sacrifice, was about attitude. And I didn't do so good at it. You know, some days are better than others in our submission to God. But the Lord gives us a promise, gives us so many promises. And that is, we confess to one another. And we can find that healing, we can find that grace, we can find that forgiveness. And that's what our offering, that's what our worship really is about. You know, singing songs and all that, that's considered worship also. But do you know that when Abraham was willing to sacrifice Isaac on the mountain, God called that worship. They weren't singing up songs, they didn't bring a band up there. Worship is obedience. And so let's just go with that in mind as we think about our offering this morning. Father God, we just thank you for your love for us that is unfailing, that it is so faithful, and that you have so much grace for us and so much mercy for us. And I just pray, Lord, that for myself and for maybe anyone else that might be relating to what I'm talking about, that you would just help us to lay down ourselves as a sacrifice, our attitudes, our wants, our desires, and just ask that you would let your Holy Spirit just come in and fill us, Lord God. Come in and completely take over. And that we'd be willing to let that happen. That we'd be willing to be humble enough. And we just thank you and praise you, Lord God, for the opportunity to give to you. We thank you for this church and all of the wonderful things that your church here in Pinellas Park is doing to reach so many people. The seats in the that are here, the people sitting in the seats that are here, are just such a small representation, even though we have completely blessed to be able to come here physically. There are so many people that this church reaches, and so we ask that you would continue to pour out your blessings, Lord, on this church and all of its ministries. And just help us, Lord God, to give the amount that you put in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
The world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. And you came along and put me back together.
Praise your holy name, Lord God. Praise your holy, holy name, your set-apart name. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice for us. Thank you for all that you're doing and all that you've done and all that you're going to do. We just thank you, Lord God, that you transcend time. You transcend all of the problems, all of the things that we think are problems, Lord God. Just thank you, Lord God, for helping us to see the big picture, see things through your eyes.
We thank you, Lord. We thank you for your presence. We come today to you with prayers for a marriage to find you and to grow strong, Lord. Prayers for Susan and for Marianne. Prayers of healing for Karen, for Lori, and for Jenny. Yes. And prayers for Ashley, for your healing as well, Lord. You know each of those situations, Lord, and exactly what those individuals need. And we thank you, Lord, that we can bring these prayers and these requests to you and that you will take them to your heart, Lord. We ask you today to be with us as we go into our service. Be with our pastor as she brings your word to us and open our hearts to what you would have us hear. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Inappropriate for a pastor to throw the Bible on the ground. Okay, that's a good start. Throwing the word around today. Okay. Good morning, everybody. Y'all awake? You need a little rest? Wow, I hear that. Happy Labor Day. Yeah, happy Labor Day weekend. I hope whatever you have planned is fun and safe. Does everybody get tomorrow off? No. I hear no's and yes's. Okay. Yeah, if you're retired, you have every day off, as Eunice is saying. That's good. Well, happy Labor Day. I was thinking about Labor Day. I like it when my sermon's around a holiday. I can tie into it. Gives me a subject matter right there at the top. I was thinking about Labor Day. I was like, what? Why do we do this? Does anybody ever wonder why we do certain things? Am I the only one? Yeah, I'm like, why do we do this? And I admit, I really didn't know too much about Labor Day. Does anybody know a lot about Labor Day? No. I will tell you some things that Labor Day is not. It is not and does really not have anything to do with the end of summer and the beginning of fall. Just step outside right now and I can tell you that, right? That's kind of an obvious. It doesn't have anything to do with the start of football season. Sorry. Wow. I'm just the messenger, people. It doesn't have anything to do with whether we can wear white now. For you fashion people. We're in Florida. We wear white all the time, don't we? Who cares? And it sure doesn't have anything to do with any kind of retail sale that might be happening at Tyrone Square Mall. I'm sorry to say it has nothing to do with those. Then you're like, what is left? I'm about to tell you. Because I love learning pretty much useless information and then sharing it with a captive audience. Labor Day was made into a national holiday in 1887 by President Grover Cleveland. Good old President Cleveland. Yeah, thank you. And it was a day to honor American workers. I think we kind of get that, right? And it was to celebrate their social and economic achievements. It was a day for workers to be celebrated, to get a break from their hard work, right? They got a day off. It's their holiday. And it was, you know, a time to just recognize all the hard work that Americans do and the labor that we put into the economy to keep it strong and to keep it moving forward. That's 1887, people. So it's been around for a long time, much before football season would have started. Sorry, Deb Carson. So it was really, truly intended as a time to take a rest, to take a break. That's really what Labor Day is all about. So some of you that have to work tomorrow, I'm so sorry. You need to talk to your employer and say, my pastor told me that this was. So I got to thinking about this rest thing, of course, was mulling around in my head. And I have some questions for you. Do you need a break? Are you tired? And of course, as your pastor, I'm not talking about just physically speaking. I'm talking spiritually speaking. Are you tired spiritually? Do you need a break? We live in a world that expects a lot from us, right? And this is a discussion maybe we can discuss later, but does the world expect that much, or do we expect this much from ourselves? I don't know. But the fact of the matter is we have a lot of things on our plate, everybody here, correct? I would assume. We have so many things that pull us for our energy and for our time. We have appointments, jobs, hobbies, families, children, pets that you got to sit outside with for hours on end now, chores, church volunteer work, vacations, emails, text messages, job promotions, hurricane preparations. That one I threw in, obviously, this week. Meetings, conference calls. I mean, the list goes on and on, correct? Some of those things might be on your list. Those are some things on my list. All of our lists are different, but we all have long, long, never-ending lists, correct? We get pulled in a million directions. And today, I want to talk about how we need to look at the Bible for all of our examples and for how we're supposed to live life, right? We agree. It's all in here. And see what the Bible has to say about rest. We must rest. For our physical, mental, and spiritual health, we need to give it a break. We need to take a break sometimes, right? We need a day to recover. And not just once a year on Labor Day, please. We need to regroup and reset multiple times during the week, during the day, during the month, whatever it is, whatever time you need. We need to do that. The word rest itself means peace, ease, and refreshment. I love refreshment. I love that part. And resting obviously has a lot of great physical benefits. It keeps your heart healthy. It reduces your stress. It keeps your blood sugar content at a normal rate. It prevents inflammation. It helps control weight. It's important for memory formation and function and clear thinking. Quality sleep, not just coffee, but quality sleep allows you to be energetic and alert. And I found a study that I'm holding on to. Pastor Tosh is going to love this. Found results of a study that says people who have 3 or more naps a week had a 37% reduced risk of heart disease. I have heart disease on both sides of my family. I need at least 3, it seems. I love to nap. So I am holding on to that. I'm like, I got to go take care of my heart. I need a nap. Oh, anyway. So we see all the physical benefits, correct? But I'm not here to talk about all those, although I wanted to throw those in for you. There are so many spiritual benefits to rest, spiritual rest. For us to be the best that we can for God, to serve others to our greatest capacity, we need to rest. I can only speak for myself. I'll admit some things to you right now. Maybe you can relate. But with no rest, I'm not very fun to be around. I'm no good to... Thank you, Deb. I'm no good for anyone, honestly. I'm irritable. I can't communicate. Words do not come to me. I'm like, yeah, I'll have to get back to you later because I can't form my sentence. I'm incredibly impatient, very short-tempered, and I'm downright just not very fun to be around. Obviously, it sounds like you can talk to Deb Carson about that, or Pastor Tosh can also verify. But if I'm all of those things, like irritable and just not fun to be around, how in the world can I do God's work when I'm like that, right? If I can't even form a sentence or be patient with someone, I can't. Those qualities are not of God. So we need to make sure we have we have physical rest so we can do God's work, and also the spiritual rest of being in his presence, just being with him to be able to do God's work. So I got to thinking, okay, so this is all great concepts, God, but I need some Bible references, please. That would be great, right? And I have three different references that we're going to go through today: Luke, Genesis, and 1 Kings. And these are the characters that we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about Jesus first. We're going to talk about God and rest. And then we're going to talk about Elijah, like the greatest prophet to ever walk the earth. So we got some high standards here. I get it. Jesus, God, and Elijah. But we're going to dive into their stories and parts of their stories where I can see where they took rest, physical and spiritual rest, to be better and use those examples in our life and the lessons that we can learn from that. So the first example, this is in no particular order. So we're going to talk about Jesus first because, well, I like him. So we're going to talk about Jesus first. Okay, I love Jesus. We're going to go to Luke 8:23 here in a minute. Now, my friend Tony Smith, I hope you're watching. She's down in the Keys in her RV. I hope she's watching at some point in time. She has a t-shirt that I absolutely love because Tony also loves naps. And her t-shirt says, "Jesus took naps. Be more like Jesus." Like, yeah, that's right, Tony Smith. So shout out to you, Tony, if you're watching. Jesus took naps. I was like, okay, Jesus took naps? All right, I need to find that out. Luke 8 is where we can find where Jesus took some rest. Luke 8:23, and I'll read 22 and 23 to get into it. One day Jesus said to his disciples, "Let's go over to the other side of the lake." So they got into a boat and set out. As they sailed, he fell asleep. A squall came down on the lake so that the boat was being swamped, and they were in great danger. Now I'll say that in the NLT version, it says, I love this, "Jesus settled down for a nap." Anybody have the NLT version that says that? There you go. I see one up there. Jesus settled down for a nap. And we see here in scriptures, I was like, okay, so Jesus settled down for a nap. What's really going on? And I love when you think about really like what's happening, what Jesus has been doing. If you look prior to that in Luke 1 through 7, well, maybe like 3 through 7 because Jesus had to be born first. But anyway, if you look at the prior chapters, you're going to see that Jesus is doing a lot of work, man. He's working. He's teaching. He's sitting with people. He's telling parable after parable after parable. He's on the move. He's walking around. He's casting out demons. He is one busy guy, right? You agree Jesus was busy? Yes. Jesus had a long list of to-dos, didn't he? Because he had a bunch of people coming to him. "I need this. I need this. Heal me. Heal me. Cast out my demons." And he finally gets to sit on a boat for just a few minutes. They're going across. And man, does a boat put anybody else to sleep? Yeah. Oh yeah, I know, right? And he settles in for a nap. He got away from the crowd. He took his moment. And I just see Jesus kind of like going off and on the boat off somewhere and just settling in and sleeping. But I get to thinking, if I had 12 of my closest buddies in a boat with me, it'd probably be hard for me to settle down for a nap. Anybody else? You're like, got 12 friends, you're on a boat. Napping is probably the last thing I'm going to think about doing, right? And Jesus probably had 12, well, he did. He had 12 of his closest friends, and they are probably still maybe trying to talk to him. We know Peter, right? Hey. And could Jesus have, like, talked with Peter? He could have had some one-on-one time. He could have scheduled disciple one-on-ones to like have time with each of the disciples. He could have still taught. Remember, Jesus is only available for his ministry for 3 years. He's got a lot to do in a little time. But he'd been working and working and working. And what I see here Jesus do is create a boundary. Anybody love to create boundaries? I hear mixed. He created a boundary and he said, "You know what? I need some physical and spiritual rest right now. I'm going to go settle in, settle down for a nap." We may have a lot of work to do. As I said before, we got long lists of things that we need to do and things that are pulling us in different directions. So did Jesus. He kind of had an important mission. Do we all agree with that? Yeah, kind of a little bit of a thing like saving the world stuff. But he still took time to create a boundary and say, "You know what, guys? I got to go settle down for a nap. And while that's what Jesus shows me in this, there's stuff to do, but there's always time to get that rest so that you could do more, because we see later, soon, I mean, as I read in the scripture, they've got the storm coming. I think we all kind of know what's going to happen, right? They wake Jesus up, he calms the storm, Peter walks on water, there's all kinds of stuff that's happening. Jesus couldn't have done all that work if he hadn't gotten his rest and filled up his cup a little bit and said, okay, thank you, God. I got that spiritual, I got that physical rest. Now I'll be able to teach these people more and more and be more for you, be better for you, be 100% for you. He was able to minister because he got his rest. The second example is God himself. God, if we go to Genesis, very beginning of this beautiful book, Genesis 2, we see in Genesis 1, God's busy, isn't he? God's busy, he's creating everything. Boy, he is on fire. Day after day, he's doing stuff. He's creating everything that we know. Awesome, right? God's creating it all. And then we see in Genesis 2:2, by the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work. And God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it, he rested from all the work of creating that he had done. God rested. Now, I want to be very clear. God was not tired, okay? Because God is God. He's not like us that can only just go so much with these human bodies and then we're done. God didn't need the rest, but he took it. He saw that what he did was good, and he's like, you know what? I'm going to take a break from this. And I think he took this rest to show us as humans in these bodies that do give out and do get tired that it is okay. You need to take a break. In fact, God commanded it, right? If you go into Exodus 20, around verses 8, you're going to see the fourth commandment out of 10. God says to rest. He says to remember the Sabbath day, keep it holy. You can do anything you want for 6 days. Work, 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 work. But then take your rest on that seventh day. What I learned from this set of scriptures is God showed us in his example, by setting his example, and we want to be obedient to God, right? God tells us how we need to live and what we need to do. He knows best for us, and he loves us so much. We need to take that rest. And I'm not telling you it has to be the Sabbath day, okay? I understand there's stuff that happens. I'll be honest with you. I work a lot on Sunday. I'm a pastor, right? We work on Sunday. It's our biggest work day. The point is, take your break and get refreshed and replenished in God. God showed us as an example. And if I don't do that, I'm not being obedient as I need to be. That's what Deacon Don talked about earlier, that obedience thing, man. We struggle with that. But in this case, God said, hey, rest is important. I'm going to show you at the very, very beginning of this book, rest is important. I need you to rest. And it's just a simple choice of hours. Do we rest, or do we just keep on pushing through our checklist of things that we think that we need to get done? When we rest, we show obedience to God. We rest in him. We get replenished through him, refreshed through Jesus spiritually and physical rest, so we can do great, better, wonderful, awesome things for God. The last example is Elijah out of 1 Kings in 19, 3 through 6 is where we're going to be. But I kind of want to give you an idea what's going on. Does anybody love the story of Elijah and Mount Carmel like me? It's awesome. Let me give you, this is Pastor Jamie's Cliff Notes version of what's happened in the verse before this, okay? 1 Kings 18, we have evil King Ahab and his sidekick, evil Queen Jezebel, are ruling at the time. They do not follow God. They're evil. I use that adjective for a reason. And there's a nice long drought that's happening. And they're praying, the people are praying to Baal through the prophets to end this drought. And Elijah's like, well, you're not going to get anywhere with that. I'll show you who the real true God is, who's going to take care of this drought. And that's my God, the big G. I'm going to call him the big G. So what we set up in 1 Kings 18 is a showdown between our God, the big G, and the prophets of Baal and Baal the god, little G. And if you haven't read it, please do. It's such a great story. And we know what happens. I mean, spoiler, if you don't know what happens, I'm going to tell you, but you're going to go back and read the story. But in 18, it's a big, spectacular miracle, and God wins. I'll just leave it at that. Big G wins. Little G, Baal, goes running, right? The prophets are doomed. And Elijah proves to the people who God is, and the drought is over. Now, you would think that Elijah is on top of the world, right? He's just won this big showdown on this mountain. And what he does, read the story. You would think that Elijah would be like dancing around, confetti would be falling from the sky. People are lifting him on their shoulders, and he's like, the interviewer's like, and what are you doing now, Elijah? And he's like, I'm going to Disney World. You would think that's what's happening. It's indeed the complete opposite of what's really happening. What happens is, in chapter 19, Jezebel is like, puts a hit out on his life, and Elijah goes running. He has no time to celebrate in the confetti, because evil Queen Jezebel is trying to kill him. So we pick up the story in 19, after the miraculous miracle. There you go. I'll use those words together. And we'll see where Elijah is here. Elijah is whipped, done, and exhausted. Let's read the verses here first. Starting in 3, Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there, while he himself went a day's journey into the desert. He came to a broom tree, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. I have had enough, Lord, he said. Take my life. I'm no better than my ancestors. Then he lay down under the tree and fell asleep. All at once, an angel touched him and said, get up and eat. He looked around, and there by his head was a cake of bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. He ate and drank and then lay down again. So here's Elijah. We find him completely done, exhausted. He really wants to just die. Did you hear that in these verses? He's completely defeated. Although just a chapter ago, he had the biggest victory for God in something that, thousands of years later, we talk about as my favorite scriptures, my favorite story of the Old Testament. But he was physically on the run and spiritually completely drained and defeated, right? But he comes to a place and he rests. He fell asleep. He settled in for a long nap, if you will, a long sleep. And the refreshment that happened to him in verse 5 and 6 was moments of rest that he needed to go on. He was at the end of his rope and running for his life, and he needed to rest. And do you see what happened when he was resting? He got ministered to by the angels, didn't he? We need to stop sometimes when we're at the end of our rope, and we need to just let God minister to us. Let God have his angels surround us, and let his angels and himself just be with us. and rest in that spiritually speaking. If we don't and we keep pressing on and doing our to-do list because we got a million chores over here and they're not going to do themselves, right? But if we don't take that time, then God can't do his thing. If Elijah would have just kept running, like, she's after me, I got to keep going, he probably would have just collapsed. I mean, there, you know, your body only goes so far, right? And spiritually speaking, too, he was so distraught. But he stopped, and in that rest, he was ministered to by God. How awesome is that? When do you need to get to, when you're at the end of your rope, do you notice and see the part where you need to stop? I just need to stop and let God minister. There are times we need that to happen. And it's super uncomfortable for us, isn't it? Is it uncomfortable? We need to just keep working it. We just need to keep working. We need to keep moving. I got things to do. I'll feel better when the list is done. I'm going to be honest with you. The list is never done. The list is never done. It's not. So why don't we take that moment and let God, just like Elijah was able to do, and just let God minister to us and help us spiritually rest in him. Please, if you're at the end of your rope, take a break and let God be there with you. When we're at our lowest is when we really need to make sure we do that. So I found a couple examples, right? Where rest is important. And I think God really wants us to take this rest seriously in our lives. And as I said before, it's not natural for us. It's not natural for us to just calm down and just sit in a moment when we've got a whole long thing to do, right? My mind goes in a million different directions if I just sit for a few minutes. But we have to be people that just sit and let God spiritually minister to us, do the things that we need to do, read our Bible, listen to good music, be in God's presence to fill us up spiritually speaking. Our busyness, our list of to-dos and things that we always need to get done, I'm going to say it. I think that's a tactic of the devil to get us completely distracted and too busy to worry about being in God's presence. The devil knows how to get to us, so he'll just throw more things on our list of busyness. And it easily distracts me, I'm going to assume maybe you, easily distracts me from my relationship with God. And to rest and to sit in God's presence and to be with God and rest physically and spiritually and mentally, it's a huge exercise in trust. We have to be people that understand that our list is long and big, but we have a God who's going to take care of it all. And I have a God that's bigger than my to-do list, right? We have to trust that if we take a moment, it's going to be okay. The world is not going to stop revolving. We're going to be all right. We will get things done as it needs to get done. It takes a lot of faith to do that. It takes a lot of trust in God to do that, because it's not in our nature in this world to just have stuff to do, busyness, and not do it. It's a true act of faith to sit, rest, get refreshed, and sit in the peace of God instead of working that list. So just as our body needs a certain amount of rest, it does, doesn't it? And a certain amount of sleep to be able to function so we can serve God, our spirit also requires that. And I encourage you to take time, look at your life, see what's going on with you, and say, you know what, I need to take this time spiritually to rest and to commune and connect with my God. Take a break. Create boundaries. Obey God's example. And then let God minister. When you're sitting in that quiet place and resting, let God minister to you so you can get through where you may be, which is at the end of your rope like Elijah was. Amen? Amen. Dear God, I thank you for this message today that we need to rest. And God, I just ask you today to just help us to be people that understand that you have everything under control, that you are bigger than all of our things that we need to do, and that you will always be there and provide what we need. And I ask that we are comfortable and become comfortable people of taking a break and resting and just being in your presence so you can do your thing, and that is be God and comfort us and be there for us when stuff is going chaotic in our lives. Help us to have the faith and trust in you to be able to rest and put things aside, to focus in on you so we can do the things that are really important, the eternal things that are important, like being there for one another and serving one another, serving this church, ministering to one another. I ask that we all can this week just really ponder these words and the message that you had for us today, God, and then to apply it to our life. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. I don't know about y'all, but I needed that word this morning. You know, I think part of the reason I struggled so much this week is just because we've had a couple of weeks of just being very, 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 very busy. And I'm sick. I've been sick for 2 weeks. And God was speaking to me as Pastor Jamie was talking, preaching, that it not only lowers your immune system physically, but it also lowered my immune system spiritually. And that I was more open to attack, more vulnerable, you know. It was just harder to have faith, you know, just all around. It's a good word. It's a good word. Thank you, Pastor.
You call me out upon the water, the great unknown, where feet may fail.
Amen.
And there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours and you are mine. Your grace abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you've never failed and you won't start now. So I will call my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters where
wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior.
Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your name.
And keep my eyes above the waves.
Thank you, Jesus.
My soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
In your presence, Lord. Thank you for filling us, Lord God, when we're empty. Lord Jesus, we just thank you for being with us as we walk out of this place. Let the Holy Spirit walk with us. Let us stay filled this week and be reminded of the word that you gave us through Pastor Jamie, to take that time, that precious time to rest, get recharged, refocused, keeping the main thing the main thing. And Lord God, we thank you for helping us just to realize that Satan is after us. And if he can't make us bad, he's going to make us busy. Anything to distract us from your agenda. Anything to make us miserable. Help us to stay focused this week, Lord God, on your agenda, your will. And part of your agenda is to rest. We thank you, Lord God. And we pray that you would be with all of us this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. That was church, people. Have a great week.